You're listening to The Critical Thought, where we challenge our listeners to use critical thinking when examining the teachings of Jehovah's Witnesses.
Hi, this is Lady C.
And this is JT. And welcome to another episode of The Critical Thought. Our guest today is Paul. He also has his own channel called Ex-Jehovah's Witness from Louisiana. We've been trying to get together actually since 2018, and we finally was able to catch up with him and get our schedules together. And we'd like to welcome Paul to our program as he will share with us what it was like growing up and being involved with the Jehovah's Witnesses.
Good morning, JT and Lady C. Thank you for having me today.
You are so welcome.
Yeah, glad to have you here, man. It's been good. Been good.
Absolutely. So, Paul, you want to give our listening audience a little bit of information, history about your growing up as a Jehovah's Witness. What was life like for you?
My dad was the first in my family to become one of Jehovah's Witnesses. Like I say, roughly when I was 3-4 years old. Before then, I'd experienced all of the regular trappings of the world, as they say. I was doing, you know, regular stuff, Christmas, birthdays and stuff. But when my dad got introduced to it through one of his coworkers at work, that's when everything started to change for me. So literally within a year, he was baptized and everything that I knew as normal went away as a small child. So, and my mom followed him shortly after that.
I was just getting ready to ask you about your mom.
Yeah, my mom followed him into it shortly after that. She did it for different reasons. Because of my dad's personality, I guess you could say. He was into a lot of things. He was running the streets. He was chasing a lot of women, being abusive to her. And she followed him into it under the belief that this would make him change. This would make him be somebody else besides who he was. But it didn't. All it did is like pour gas on the fire. That's all.
Let me ask you, because it's very... Well, it's not odd, but it's very unusual many times, because we know how the organization works, for a man many times to get involved in religion. We know women, they're in the church.
Mm-hmm.
Do you, you mentioned that you're, I think you mentioned our conversation once before, that your dad came out of Vietnam.
Yes. Yes.
And we know that people who came out of Vietnam, they came back to America that didn't want them, that rejected them. Do you think that the message of Jehovah's Witnesses at least resonated to him, that made him at least even have an interest? You think that may have impacted him as well?
Definitely. It played a big part in it, because just things I can remember him saying as a child growing up. It's like, my dad would require me to say yes ma'am and no ma'am to women, but to men I couldn't say yeah and nah, but I only had to say yes and no, because he said the yes sir and no sir and the following of orders reminded him of being in the military, and he didn't volunteer, he was drafted. So it definitely played a part in how he viewed the world coming back out of Vietnam and the way he was treated.
Yeah, that is so true. That is one of the things that as witnesses we were taught. We're looking for certain people, and that's people who have had issues, challenges, right, upset with, you know, life in general. That stuff really appeals to them. So Paul, what about siblings? Do you have any older brothers or sisters, or were any born after you were born that became part of the, you know, your dad? They grew up in this witness family as well?
Yeah, I have two younger brothers. They're quite a bit younger than me. One is almost 9 years younger than me, and the next one is almost 12 years younger than me. So they were actually born into it. So they don't know anything about, you know, any celebrations or anything like that outside of witnesses. But they were just like me. Even though I was substantially older than them, they saw the things going on around them, and they knew it wasn't right.
Yeah. How strict were your parents when you were growing up in the religion?
Everything that I did was basically, my dad looked at it like whether or not I was going to be an embarrassment to him as far as the other friends and stuff. He would use the witness terms with it or whatever, but basically it was whether or not I was going to cause him to be an embarrassment to them. So yeah, he was very strict. And it wasn't that, I'm not gonna say he didn't believe the teachings, he did, but it wasn't the fact that I was going against Jehovah. It was the fact that I was gonna make him look bad to the other friends.
Oh, so yeah.
It was, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, that was real big. I remember, because everybody's positions and their status.
Right, right.
I mean, when I was coming on, the big thing was a man being head of his house.
Yes.
He got his family in order. And when they use that phrase, he has his family in order.
Yes.
That carried an interesting connotation in terms of what they would do to whip everybody in shape. So with your father, was he trying to reach out for positions?
Oh yeah, definitely. I don't know that he ever put it in his goal to be an elder, but he made ministerial servant, I think, twice before they demoted him or whatever you call it, and got this fellowship for the things he was doing. And when he came back, he made ministerial servant again, and they took it away from him again. So, yeah, and it was he wanted me to be that person too, you know. And I never was able to really talk to my dad because of his expectations, and, you know, I knew the driving force behind his thought process, so I couldn't be honest with him and tell him that that wasn't what I wanted. So, yeah, I pretended when he would mention about being a minister, sir, and I'm like, yeah, you know, knowing I had no intentions of doing that. You know, whenever he would mention about going to Bethel, I'd be like, yes, knowing I'm not going, you know. So it basically was for appearances with my dad.
Yeah. So what did he do? What did he do as y'all guys was growing up as kids? To make everybody fall in line or to at least give the appearance of falling in line?
You did what he said or you got beat.
Wow.
Bottom line.
Was that a constant thing that, you know, yeah. did you feel like every day you were like walking on eggshells?
Definitely. I hid who I was the entire time. Yeah. There were certain things you couldn't say, certain things you couldn't do. There was no expressing yourself. There was no asking why. There was no explanations or nothing. You just did what you were told.
Amazing.
Or you suffer the consequences for it. Huh?
What about your brothers? Did your other two brothers get baptized?
No, they didn't. Because they saw what I was going through, so they didn't. So they played it out as long as they could. My brother underneath me, the second one, my dad put him out at 15 also because he refused to go to the King of Hall. He didn't want to play the game anymore, so he just flat out refused to go. And my dad put him out that night with the clothes on his back.
How old was he?
15.
Ooh, where did he go?
Yeah. I went and picked him up. He called me and I picked him up and he came stay with me for a little while. And then he stayed with my grandmother until he finished high school and he was out on his own. And my dad never offered to let him come back, never offered to help him, anything. He put him out.
Yeah. Wow, that's going to be really tough.
Yeah.
So, how did things work out with you how old were you when you left home?
Yeah,
I had just turned 19. I was a little different than my brother, as I explained in my video. I pretended fake because I knew I had nowhere else to go. So when he would threaten to put me out, I would pretend to fall in line and just bide my time. When I was roughly 14, 15, I had made up my mind that I wanted no parts of the Jehovah's Witnesses. I was just waiting until I got old enough to walk away from it. So I basically came up with that philosophy. I just kept my head down, pretended, did the talks, pretended to knock on the doors and field service, whatever I needed to do to make my dad and the other people in the congregation leave me alone. And once I finished high school, I got me a full-time job and saved money. And when I got ready to pull the trigger and move, I went and got me an apartment and everything. And I didn't tell anyone. I got all my stuff together and I moved out of my parents' house. And I never went back to the King of Hall again after then. But it wasn't like a normal relationship with parents to where I could go to my parents and tell them, hey, I'm thinking about moving out on my own and they would help me or whatever. No, I had to really basically sneak out in the middle of the night.
Do you think that there's a lot of kids in congregations all around the world who are literally faking, as they say, fake it till you make it? They're basically just bidding their time.
Definitely. Definitely. There was a man, it's been quite some time ago, but there was a young man came to my door out in field service with his I guess that was his father. But of course, I didn't know him. But his dad was standing behind him and I could tell that he was being coerced to do this. I could just look in the young man's face and I could see myself, you know. And his dad was standing back behind him with this approving look, you know, while the kid did his presentation. And I wasn't rude to him or anything. I just basically told him that I wasn't interested in hearing it. But I could see that this kid was being forced to do this. You know, because his dad was standing back, like, critiquing him, you know.
Yeah.
And I think that that's a problem throughout the organization. Because the vast majority of the teenagers that were in it when I was going, the vast majority of them don't go anymore. The only ones that still go is the ones whose families is deep into it. And they know that they'll lose everything.
Yeah.
So they still go.
Yeah. You know? Yeah. And you know, that was real nice of you that you didn't tear into him. Unfortunately, sometimes former Jehovah's Witnesses, they take their frustration and their anger, they take it out on the wrong people.
Right, right.
You know, these are just cogs on a wheel. And so that was really good, man, that you didn't do that, because I've talked to people and they said, well, afterwards, that young kid, he was just like, that's right, he was just like you, man, just like you.
Exactly. Okay.
Knowing what you know now about the Jehovah's Witnesses or just the way people do things in life, how, if you could go back and live your life over again, what are some of the things that you think you could have done differently?
As far as while I was in the organization or
when you were growing up with your father? Oh. Is that a hard question?
Yeah, because I don't see anything that I could have. Yeah, there's nothing that I could
have done. You have no control.
Right. I mean, I was a kid. I was just trying to live a normal life.
You know, sometimes you wouldn't, because if you would have went to Adult Protective Services, I mean, Child Protective Services,
no,
this could have ended up in a foster system.
It's not then, not then. This ain't the day.
This is the 70s and the 80s we're talking about. If I'd have called Child Protective Services, they would have told my dad to.
They sure would have.
Right.
Oh my God.
Yeah, it was pretty bad. Today kids tell you, hit me, I'm gonna call him, hit me, I'm gonna call him. You know, but back in the day, man, they could knock you out and
you were really in a bad situation.
Yeah, he's in a bad situation. There was no child protective services.
There's nothing you could. So it sounds to me like your dad needed to get some kind of help.
No, because everybody he surrounded himself with thought that was the proper way to do things. You know, I mean, and I related this story in my video. The one time I did try to reach out for help, he was an elder. Him and my dad were friends, you know, and I had gotten to know him from working in his business over the summer. He hired me there for a summer job two years in a row. And I decided one day to confide in him and tell him, you know, the things that were going on, because I wasn't aware that he understood the way my dad was behaving when no one was looking, you know. So I came in his office of his business and I sat down and I talked to him, and I basically broke it all down to him and told him what we weren't doing, what we were going through. And he assured me that he was going to talk to my dad. Well, he talked to him, but he simply told him everything that I said. And he ended it by what JT said earlier, told my dad that he didn't have control of his house. And my dad came home. And that was one of the worst beatings that I got, because I put his business out in the street. I told things that went on in our household. You know, so at that point, I never uttered another word. I suffered in silence. There was literally no one for me to go to.
Yes, that is very important. That's a very important point. And that's what makes this organization so dangerous, because the outlets that people think that they have, they are not really outlets. And
right.
Much has not really changed today. I mean, if someone went to the elders would feel, and that's the culture. Remember we was talking about the culture before we got started?
Right.
If a child comes to me as an elder and tells me that brother so-and-so is not doing, then as an elder, I'm going to feel my obligation. I got to go tell him. And then, of course, the problem is the way most elders would do it is, like you said, the brother, you need to get your house in order, man. You need to check your wife and check your kids. And of course, what does that mean, checking? Mm-hmm. Well, unfortunately, in the world of Jehovah's Witnesses, it could actually mean some type of physical confrontation that you're going to have with your wife. I know brothers I've heard over the years, man, their wives go to the elders, my husband, either, and man, they get home, but they get a beat down.
Yes.
It reminds me of when a Jehovah's Witness has an issue with one of the elders. And they send a letter to the Watchtower Society.
Yes.
And they send the letter back with another letter to the elders on how to take care of that person. And that's probably how they're doing everything too, the elders, with the sisters, the elders' wives, or the kids, you know, because it's all about perception.
Everything is about the brand, the image. How does it make you look? And that becomes the paramount thing. In this organization, in families, how do we look to the friends, you know, how do we look to the brothers? And so in order to get everybody in line, like you said, it often does result in very, very harsh treatment of family. This loving, kind conversation. Man, that stuff don't happen for the most part.
No.
Yeah, so if you take a look at this Watchtower that's on the screen, this is a Watchtower that was a study article. And here the Watchtower Society takes that scripture about not sparing the rod, but beat the child. Not only were they teaching this to Jehovah's Witnesses, but they was providing, as you can see for yourself, an illustration of what needs to be done. And what makes this so ironic is there was recently a governing body that was sitting on a hearing. It's called the Royal Commission in Australia. And he was asked point blank, do y'all teach and believe in corporal punishment? And he said, no. And it's very unfortunate that because people don't know the background of Jehovah's Witnesses, this is what formed the basis for so many young Jehovah's Witnesses growing up to be taken to the back second and third school and beaten right at the Kingdom Hall. I remember Bible studies. A Bible study would bring their children to the Kingdom Hall. One of the things that the witnesses would teach a Bible study, you need to take him in the back and let him know he can't be planted. And so you would actually see people who were merely Bible studies taking their child to the back, because child don't want to sit in a little two-hour meeting, somebody give them a sad talk. And they would take them in the back, and you would hear them discipline the child. And they would come back, little child be sniffling and stuff. And I remember you hearing these experiences, and we would laugh. You would hear the circular sibling would say things like, one little brother, when his mom was going to take him in the back, he says, "Oh no, mama, I'll sit here." You know, and so we accepted those things, yeah. And this is what led to a lot of Jehovah's Witnesses literally being abused by their parents, because the parents, this is what they were being taught.
Right. Well, this one sister in our congregation, when I used to live in Michigan, and we talked about this after we had left the organization, because she left as well. And she said she remembered this little kid that was getting ready to be thrown, taken back to the back room to get spanking. She said he would holler, "Save me, Jehovah. Save me, Jehovah." I was like, oh, my God. Well, do you think, Paul, that your father really believed Watchtower teachings, though?
Oh, yeah. I think he believes them. I think he was, like a lot of people, he was trying to have his cake and eat it, too. He believed the teachings, but he still wanted to do what he wanted to do. And he felt like he could do whatever he, to this day, he still feels like he can do what he wants to do as long as the witness people don't know what he's doing. You know? And a lot of them are living the exact same way to this day. My dad is 73. Yeah, he still has that double standard, you know, the way of living. So recently, yeah, my oldest niece, this was last year, she graduated from high school, and my youngest brother and my dad still communicate, you know. They because my brother's not baptized, and my dad realized he screwed up, I guess, with me and my second brother, so he tried to salvage a basic relationship with my youngest brother, but it's very dysfunctional. But anyway, my brother was trying to have a graduation party for his daughter when she was getting out of high school, and my dad has a lot of room where he lives. So he went and asked my dad about having the party there, and it was during COVID. So he was telling my dad, you know, it's not going to be a lot of people, just immediate family, you know, and he went to naming the people that he was going to invite. And when he got to my name, he said, my dad looked at him and said, no, he's not welcome here.
Yeah.
And it's simply because I've told him that I don't want to have anything to do with Jehovah's Witnesses.
Yeah.
So it is. He has chosen to not socialize with his oldest son because of what a religion told him to do.
Yeah, it's very powerful. One of the things that you mentioned about your dad, I remember you had mentioned this in the conversation about the double life.
Yes.
This is something that's very fascinating about Jehovah's Witnesses. You get different Jehovah's Witnesses. You get those who are like Ricky Righteous. Then you get those who just stone worldly. But then you get that other group, man. These are guys who they're living double lives.
Yes, yes, yes.
And
I did it too. I mean, I did it because I was forced to. I knew I was. I say this all the time. The thing that I learned from being a Jehovah's Witness as a kid was how to be an actor. I need an Academy Award for the performances that I put on.
Yeah.
No, I mean, I had to. I wasn't given a choice. I learned to be real, real good at it. People would look at me and they would say, "Oh no, Paul wouldn't do that." When Paul did it, you know. So
yeah,
because I had to hide from him. I had to hide it from him. You know? know.
Yeah, we have to do a lot of fakery. We come to the
yes,
and that's one of the, and me and ladies were talking. That's one of the things that we all did as Jehovah's Witness. That brother gave a fine talk today. Man, he put everybody to sleep.
And so
we just always fake stuff.
Right.
As you look back to the type of direction that the organization has given, especially when it comes to the child rearing, how to discipline kids, do you think that as Jehovah's Witnesses discipline kids in this with this corporal punishment many times, do you think that they literally believe this is what God wants them to do?
I believe they've been brainwashed to believe it.
Yeah.
I believe that the things that they've been told and the scriptures that have been used to reinforce those beliefs. Yeah, I do believe they believe it.
Yeah.
You know, I know that my parents believe it. My mom still socializes with me. And I know that my mom loves me. She does. But I do believe that my mom is handicapped. My mom, she depends on me to take care of her, basically. And but I do believe that if she wasn't handicapped, that if she had the means to be able to do and provide for herself, that if they told her not to have anything to do with me, she would listen to them.
Oh yeah, yeah. That's a very common thing we see. I mean, it's very ironic that parents have to come back and rely on their kids that they kick to the curb, but they're oftentimes forced to. And it's a good thing on your part as well, because for some witnesses who've left, it's very difficult for them to come back and help out because of the way they parents treat. And it varies from everybody. Everybody's circumstances is different. Why I don't dog anybody, because I wasn't there when you was going through.
Right.
So you, but there are individuals like yourself who we talked to someone, you know, it's a gay couple.
Right.
And the parents, you know, just hated them, wouldn't talk to them. And then when they got sick, nobody at Kingdom Hall was going to help out. And they had to move in with their child and their partner. And they take good care of them. They make sure they got everything they need. And so, it's just an ironic thing.
My mother's going through that right now. My mom had three sisters. She was the oldest. And when they joined the Witnesses back in the 70s and 80s, they were instructed that the Witnesses are going to be your family now. You know, you basically disavow your fleshly family. And my mom followed that. And she didn't disavow them, but she stopped socializing with them on a regular basis. And, you know, she started spending her time more with the sisters and the brothers and stuff. Well, fast forward 40 years now. You know, my mom's not in the best of health, and the Witnesses that she thought were going to be there for, they're not. You know, she told me one elder told, and my mom was deeply hurt by this, but it wasn't enough to make her stop going. But she said the brother looked at her, an elder, and told her, "Where's your family? They're supposed to do that for you."
Amen.
And I'm like, but they told you 40 years ago that you didn't need your family. Yeah. And now my aunts, and I'm not saying that they're right, but I understand they're penalizing her for turning her back on them 40 years ago. Oh, yeah. They won't do anything for her now, you know. Yeah. So
who, your mom?
She doesn't understand. Understand why they won't do it. Yeah, but you know,
it's that warped value that the Watchtower gives us. I mean, think about this. They teach you have very little to nothing to do with your family who are not interested in the truth, and then at 20, 30, 40 years later, go to them and get all of this survival help that you need.
Then
like you said, the Witness, because they've been so conditioned and so brainwashed, they're saying, why won't you help me?
Right. Exactly.
Let me say this, Paul, that's a first, because you know, in all the time that we've been doing our activism and stuff, I have never heard of a Jehovah's Witness family members not wanting to help them after they left. That's amazing.
No. It's not the Jehovah's Witness. My aunts are not Jehovah's Witnesses.
That's what I'm saying.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
Yeah.
I never heard them say that the non-Jehovah's Witness family wouldn't help them.
Yeah. My mom is still a witness.
Yeah. I've never heard of a non-Jehovah's Witness not helping the Jehovah's Witness after they woke up and said, "Hey, look, I need your help." That's the first time for me.
Yeah, that's unusual. Because most, in our case, our family were like, we feel sorry for y'all. And so they realized how crazy we were.
They look at it a little differently, because I've actually talked to my aunts to find out why they feel the way they feel.
Wow.
And that's what they said. It was like, you know, your mom was an adult. She chose to stay there with your dad and endure that abuse. And we tried to talk to her. We tried to get her out, and she wouldn't listen to us. You know? Yeah. So she made a choice to stay. That's basically the way that they feel. So
yeah, and
now 40 years later, and you know she's reaping this. My dad walked off and left her and went and married another woman that's 3-4 years older than me. You know, my mom is struggling now, so they figuring the old saying, "You reap what you sow."
Yeah,
that's the way they look at it now.
You know? Exactly. Oh, wait a minute. Wait. Hold a second. Your father and mother are no longer together.
No,
my after dad, all this stuff.
No, my dad left my mom, and that's a whole another backstory. But the house that they were living in was getting ready to get foreclosed on, and my dad just basically left her there and moved in with a new woman that he eventually married, and they turned the power off and everything. And after 3-4 days, my mom in there without the power off. That's when she called me to come get her. So that was 17 years ago.
That's
he basically
crazy.
Just abandoned her. Yeah, he basically just abandoned her for the new woman, and the new woman is not a witness. You know, she's heavily into the Baptist church, but
that is insane. You know why I'm saying so? It's because you said that during COVID, your father said that you couldn't come to his house.
Yes.
Because you're not a Jehovah's Witness, and here he done took up with somebody that ain't even a witness.
Yeah, he's hypocritical.
Your father got some serious problems.
Yes, I've always wanted a relationship with my father, but it just never happened. You know.
Yeah.
And it's like now we are, and it's ironic because people tell me that I look like a spitting image of my dad.
No,
but we don't have any. He's my father. That's it. We don't have any.
Yeah.
Anything that connects us, you know, so
this religion really wreaks havoc on families. Yeah. And you know, just having this conversation with you right now, you know, there's no rhyme or reason. You don't understand it. It makes no sense. And obviously there was something that happened to your father when he was in the military that really gave him the stronghold towards this religion, making him think that this is the way to go. Because, you know, and even with your mother, like, if you want to, like, go back through the years with your mother, your aunts, and they were talking about, oh, we talked to your mother and said you need to get out of that bad relationship. Can you imagine what your life would have been like if your mother would have listened to her sisters?
Yes. I say that all the time. I'm like, I try not to sit and dwell on it on a daily basis. But as I mentioned in my video, I do feel robbed. You know, I do feel like a lot of things were stolen from me because of this, because of my family's involvement in it. You know, so.
Just something as simple as having good family relationships.
Right.
Would take
right.
It,
right.
You know, it's almost like, you know, back in the day, we always talk about how when people got therapy and of course, in the African-American community, you know, going to a psychologist just is not something that they did.
Well,
but it seems like if your father could have gotten that help, then maybe he could have gotten, you know, past all the issues that he was putting on his family.
Yeah, with all of the things that my mom has had to endure, you know, lifetime of infidelity and beatings and stuff like that from my dad. My mom is in, even to this day, she's 72 years old, and she's in dire need of mental health help. And she refuses to go because she said the brothers told her she just needs to pray more.
That's right. Gotta get out and feel serious more.
That's what they teach.
Yeah, that's what they
but
teach.
But I just find it so interesting because, like, when, like, even with the Critical Thinkers channel, one of the things that we try to encourage people to do, you know, do the critical thinking. And in my own personal life, I like to reflect on things that happen to me. And it's like sometimes if you can help people to reflect, maybe she doesn't want to look at it because she realizes that she made mistakes.
Yeah.
And some people can't come to terms with realizing that they made those mistakes. So maybe one day she will, you know, listen to you and what you're saying, but she definitely needs to talk to somebody.
Yeah, she won't do it. I've tried to encourage her. You know, she won't do it. So
yeah, it's a double whammy. Like Lady C mentioned, you have the African American culture, which doesn't really gravitate toward professional help many times,
right?
And then you add, that's what I tell you, you know, if the black don't get you, the Jehovah's Witness will. You know, I always tell people all the time. So you have a double whammy. You're part of a religion that does not encourage that. Historically, it's always go out and field service, read more magazines, come to more meetings, and you'll be okay. That's always been the solution to every Jehovah's Witness problem.
Yes.
And it doesn't work.
That's
yes.
true.
Yes.
Do you, Paul, think that if your father would not have been one of Jehovah's Witnesses, your life would have been a little simpler, easier?
I would like to think that would be the case, but I mean, who knows? You know, I think just by nature, the Jehovah's Witness stuff played into my dad's character, into his personality, because he's a very controlling person just by nature. You know, he feels like I have literally seen my dad get rid of friends because they disagreed with him. Because if he says, my dad's type of person, where if he tells you the sky is green and you look at the sky and you say, no, it's blue. And he's going to tell you again, no, it's green. And when you tell him, I don't know what you're seeing, but I'm seeing blue, he's going to stop talking to you because you're disagreeing with what he says.
Yeah.
Right.
That's the type of person he is. Yeah. You know?
And one, so one that, things, and that, yeah, go that, mm-hmm, go ahead. Well, what I was going to say is, I got this book called Psychopath Free. I'll probably edit this out of here. But when you get certain personality types, mm-hmm, there's nothing you can do to reason with those individuals.
Right, right.
So when you were coming up with your father, the question that I asked before, do you think it would have been better? I feel like now, like stepping back and looking into what you just got through saying, it seems like he would have been the same person. But as JT always used to say, that people have bad families, and then when you throw Jehovah's Witnesses into the mix, it just explodes.
Yeah.
Yeah. My daddy, my father used the teachings as a Jehovah's Witnesses to validate the way he behaved. You know, he would always say that, you know, he's the head of the household and he makes the decisions and that kind of stuff. And, you know, he would always, as he was doing wrong, he would quote scriptures and throw it in there at you. So that's why I never really, somebody quoting scriptures and quoting the Bible to me, it means nothing to me now, because my dad did it so much and I would watch him do the opposite of what he just quoted. So, yeah.
That's really rough.
Yeah, that's I'm gonna tell you, man, probably one of the most powerful teachings for Jehovah's Witnesses is head of house.
Yes, yes.
Because the last thing you need to do is get a he-man,
and then you
tell him God says it's okay. Oh my goodness.
Right. I feel so,
the women and children will suffer.
It's just the opposite of me. Me and my wife have been together 30 years now, but I'm just the opposite of my dad because of that. Most of the time, my wife gets mad at me because I'm like, just do whatever you're going to do. Just leave me alone. I'm not trying to control what you do. Whatever it is,
I was going to ask you about that, Paul. That was my next question, was going to be, how did that affect your relationships after you left home? But as you're saying, you've been married for 30 years.
Yeah.
But what I see you do here is you went from 100 to zero, right?
I intentionally tried to do the opposite of what my dad did with me. Household I grew up in. I'm not going to say that I never physically disciplined my kids. I did, but it was extremely rare because I felt like I can talk to them and explain to them why the things that they're doing is not the right course of action, you know? So, and it worked most of the time, only when they would be in little badass boys. So basically, they would just go ignore me. Then I'd have to, you know, and it was just, you know, pluck upside the head or something like that, just to get their attention, you know. But my dad, it wasn't like that. My dad was, you got hit with whatever was at hand, you know. Yeah. So
I think that was normal. Yeah. That was normal.
I mean, literally for some parents, when they say a beating, they literally meant a beating. And my parents, they would tap out their legs or whatever, but they never beat us. I mean, I had kids I went to school with, man. They would come to school with whips on, you're like, good.
Yes, yes. Oh, that,
my
was, that
folks
was
never did
no
crazy.
Yeah,
yeah, that was abuse.
But you say you have a wife and kids, and I know that you walked away from the Jehovah's Witnesses. How did the relationship? Did your children get to have a relationship with their grandparents?
No, not really, because of the relationship with my father. And there were certain things that I would let him do with my kids. You know, I would not allow them to take them to the Kingdom Hall. You know what I'm saying? I would not allow them to push that. Yeah, I would not allow them to push the my mom, and this might sound a little harsh, but my mom gave my son one of the My Book of Bible Stories, gave it to my youngest son once. Mm-hmm. I threw it in the trash. No, I didn't want my kids being exposed to that stuff. You know?
Yeah.
That was smart. Because I just talked to, we just had a conversation with some people the other day, and they talked about that My Book of Bible Stories and how it was a scary place to be. So that was very smart on your part to get rid of that book.
Everything that I was denied, I encouraged my kids to participate in, because I did not want them to be in this world and be handicapped because they don't know how to function in the world.
Yeah.
When I left home at 19 years old, I struggled with general knowledge of how things in the world work. You know, as I said in my video that I made, just something as simple as a checking account. My parents didn't talk to me about stuff. You know, I learned from watching other people or seeing other things or whatever. But, you know, I knew that a checking account, you put your money in there, you write checks or whatever. But I didn't understand the consequences for, and this is the absolute truth. I did not understand the consequences for what happens when you don't have money in the bank. So
don't go well.
When I started writing checks and they were still taking them, I was like, oh, okay, I'll just pay them later when I get the money.
I'll pay them later. Yeah, I'll put the money in. It'll be good.
It's not how it works. No, yeah. But just something as simple as that. I made sure that my kids were not, you know, gullible like that, to where they didn't understand the world around them, you know.
Yeah.
And to this day, at 72 years old, my mom cannot function in the world. I have to do everything for her because she truly does not understand how things work.
Yeah.
She's been sheltered in that bubble for so long. You know?
Yeah.
Oh, that's
the organization does keep its people in a bubble. And like I said, when you combine that with maybe your family didn't do finances, with them being a Jehovah's,
right.
it just adds another layer on it.
Right.
Now, at this point, have you ever talked to your wife and your son about your Jehovah's Witness experience?
I haven't heard anything from them. I told them the entire thing. And my wife has been around me for a long time, so she's seen my dad in action. You know, so okay. She's seen my parents, how they act, you know. To explain some of my shortcomings, I guess, some of the reasons why I have some of my quirks or why I may not be fully adjusted all the way, I had to tell them these are the things that have affected me. So, you know, this might be I'm not a psychologist, but it may have affected me in certain kind of ways to, you know, you wonder, well, why does Paul act like that? This is why he acts like that.
Yeah. And we encourage people, man, if you are married to a person who is not one of Jehovah's Witnesses and not familiar with it, tell them, because this helps them to understand a lot of things that we still have hangups with. We still struggling with.
Right. And I've struggled over the years or whatever. And, you know, I've told my wife that because I had to pretend, because people expected certain things from me or whatever for a long time, I still pretended even when I was away from there. When I was around certain people, you know, I felt like I had to put on this act because they're going to judge me.
Yeah.
It really took me a while to get out of that frame of mind that these people are watching me and they're going to judge me and they're going to go back and tell and that kind of stuff, you know. So
wow, yeah, it's
I can see amazing. That. Yeah. I can really see that happening because when Trust. We first left Watchtower, that's how I was. I didn't feel comfortable around people. I wasn't pretending, but I will tell you that I got to the point where I wasn't going to tell everybody that I was an ex-witness. Every time I walked into a room, I didn't feel like I had to announce myself being an ex-witness.
Oh yeah.
I don't do that anymore. Yeah. Back when I was being forced to go, I didn't admit to it. As I said in my video when I made it, oh no. Tell nobody.
I ain't tell nobody.
The guys in the neighborhood knew because they would see me having otherwise, people outside around, no, I didn't admit that to nobody.
Don't blame me.
How were you impacted in terms of school, athletics, and college opportunities because of the religion?
I was, I'm 6'5". Well, 6'4" now. I'm old. I've shrunk a little, but 6'4". But
platform shoes will get you back up there.
I was extremely good at basketball. The Witnesses used to get together and play on the weekend sometime, whatever. But, you know, I played throughout the city in my, you know, against guys that were playing high school ball and college ball and the two universities that are in my city. And I'm really not tooting my own horn or anything like that, but I was extremely good. It just came naturally to me. You know, I didn't have to struggle at it. And the coach of my high school used to try to pressure me to play. And this is, again, I relate the story in my video. He would try to pressure me to play, and I wasn't being honest with him. I was just telling him, nah, coach, I don't want to play. When in reality, I knew my dad wouldn't let me play. So I finally fessed up to him one day, sort of. I told him that my dad wouldn't allow me to play. And he was like, why? And I was like, I don't know. That's the part that I wasn't being honest with, but I knew. And I didn't expect him to push it any further, but he took it upon himself to contact my dad. And the school brochure was a thing then. And my dad showed up at school with school brochure. And needless to say, everybody knew. So at that point, my coach, he kind of left me alone, but I could see he felt pity for me, because I was really good. And there was, I'm not going to say there's no doubt, because anything could happen. But with the talent that I had at that point in my life, I knew that I could have parlayed it into an athletic scholarship of some type, but wasn't an option for me. I got a job and became a regular guy in the workforce.
Yeah.
This is a terrible religion.
Yeah,
it's
it is.
A terrible place to be.
It really is. And what bothers me more is well, it doesn't really bother me because I understand it. But in terms of, it's just sad. This is a story that's been told so many times. And witnesses, when you ask them or you inquire about this, they realize this is what they teach and what they believe. And they're embarrassed. Most Jehovah's Witnesses are literally embarrassed. Some of the most diehard witnesses, they're embarrassed to discuss this aspect of their religion, that it does discourage as talented and most brightest kids from pursuing things that they can do. And so they'll make up all kinds of excuses. We can go to trade school. Well, we ain't talking about trade school. And athletics and so forth. And so they try their best to paint a happy picture that we're not extreme, but we are. We will put a child on the stage and 40,000 people will clap.
Yes.
I turned down Yale last week.
Yes, 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 yes.
And so, and you know what, Paul, when you left, because of the abuse, because of the double standards, because of all the things that you saw in the congregation, you didn't believe this was the truth. Is this correct?
Oh, yeah, that's correct. I knew it wasn't, because I knew what they were doing, and I also knew what I was doing. And I knew that there was no way that this God or any God would condone the stuff that I saw going on around me and the stuff that I was involved in. There's no way.
Here you are decades later. When did you realize that this is a religion that you needed to speak out about? Because I know you contacted, we touched base back in 2018.
Right.
When did you reach the point? Because remember, most people, when they leave a church, they just gone. Man, I left Mount Nebo. Right. I'm gone. But for former Jehovah's Witnesses, they gravitate and end up back on channels like this decades later.
Yeah.
Which really shows that in some way and in some fashion, this stuff is so ingrained into us that it really never leaves. We might go on with our lives, get married, have kids, but something at the very core of our being is still ticks. And I guess it has to do with the fact that we still have people who are still in.
Yes.
Who are constant reminders. Your mom, every time you look at your mom and in her face, you're saying to yourself, like many of us are, who have parents or family, this wouldn't be like if it hadn't been a religion. We wouldn't be here today.
Exactly. I look at my mom whenever I see her, and I see her multiple times a week. I'm her caretaker. But I look at my mom and I see that she's basically wasted her life. She's thrown her life away in this religion, and she's gotten nothing from it but a bunch of promises of this paradise that's supposed to be coming. That's right around the corner. That's right around that long corner. That's long, that long 40-year, 50-year corner that ain't never showed up yet.
Man, that's deep. That's
amazing. It just tears at my heart to hear how you were treated and how, because I've heard of people that came through, the very difficult family, fathers there, and just won't support the children. And of course, my dad didn't get baptized until years later after I graduated from high school.
The outside looking in, none of these people, they didn't see anything wrong with us because my dad hid it, they thought that we were the model family, but we weren't. It was dysfunctional as you could believe,
Oh, so then that means that while your dad was telling you, why can't you be like such and such kid, some other brother in the congregation was looking at your family and saying, why can't you be like Paul?
Maybe some, but the ones that really know me didn't.
but that was because they knew you. For those who didn't, if they just looked at the outward package, they were like, oh, you know, we need to be more like them. They're on field service all the time, you know what I mean?
And you know, I think this is so important because here's my thing. Paul, you lived your life. You had this terrible situation that you had to deal with in your family. Mm-hmm. Today we have help that we can get to children. Do you think that living in the year 2021, if this was happening to you and your family, would you have felt comfortable reaching out to someone for help outside of the family?
Yeah, I think so, because now there are other resources. At that time, the only person that I had to go to was the elders. You know, I mean, yeah, I could have went to my non-Jehovah's Witness family, but there was nothing that they could do to help me. You know, so I needed someone that could help me change it from within or get me out of that situation. None of my extended family was in the position to take me in. You know, so, and there was nobody within the organization that was going to do anything to change it. You know, so I just had to play the cards I was dealt, basically. But in today's society, there's so many other resources that you have to reach out to get help now, you know, if you truly want to go, you know.
Yeah. And right. So that is a resource that, man, when you and I were coming along and my wife was coming along, who are you going to go to? You're 14, 15 years old and you on the internet back in the day, you know, who were you going to, there was nobody to contact.
Right.
But today,
right.
man, it is, we just say it all the time. The internet is a game changer.
Yes. The information is at your fingertips now. You know, before I had to dig for the information. You know what I'm saying? I had to go and look at other resources, books and encyclopedias and that kind of stuff to dig the information when I did it back in the early 90s, because I say my mom was getting on me and the few people that I did know whenever I would see them somewhere, because I completely removed myself from the circles of the Jehovah's Witnesses. So I wasn't socializing with them anymore. But whenever they would run up on me, they would be like, "So when are you coming back to Jehovah?" You know what I'm saying? Yeah. And I would be like, I would change the subject of stuff until I got to the point where I would tell them never. You know, but I started to do a little research to try to see for myself if what these people were saying was true. And just the stuff that I was able to uncover back then showed me that, no, this is not true. Yeah.
Did you ever read Crisis of Conscience by Ray Franz?
No, I never got a chance to read it. I've heard about it though, but it's ironic because of course I was in the organization back when all that was happening.
Yeah.
And basically, I remember the talks and stuff and the whispering and stuff being said about him. And they treated him like he was the devil himself.
So, first cousin, man. First cousin. Yeah. Satan's first cousin.
And so then when you started doing research in the recent years, when did you actually stumble across? I know you contacted us in 2018.
Right.
Is that when you actually went online to start doing research about witnesses then?
Yeah, well, actually, I came upon you all and a few more just playing on the internet, playing on YouTube, whatever. And I came up and I was like, okay, this is a thing now. Okay, it's like it wasn't available to me back then. So
I
went down a proverbial rabbit hole. I watched a ton of y'all's videos and a ton of other people's videos. And I was like, okay, well, maybe I can give a perspective to where somebody may have lived the same type of life that I live. Yeah. But they weren't able to speak out on it, you know. So, and I'm so far removed from it now to where I have nothing to lose, you know. So, you know, I know that there won't be a relationship with my father, you know. I know that. And with my mother, sad to say, but she's not in a position where she can stop talking to me, you know. So,
exactly.
What are some of the double standards
that you find in the congregation with these brothers? Because I know you mentioned that, that you saw these brothers doing things that wasn't right. You know,
this is nothing major, but it was this was a sister, and she was notoriously known for being a gossiper and being a spreader of mess and rumors and stuff like that. She was notoriously known for this. And during the Watchtower study, I never forget, I was a kid. I may have been about 10, 11, something like that. And during the Watchtower study, she answered a question, and the topic was about nosiness, being a busybody or whatever. And she raised her hand and commented and quoted that scripture about being a busybody, better than the affairs of others. And when she said that, I did like that. I was like, my dad slapped me upside the head.
Like, oh my God.
Turn around, boy. Not now.
Oh, that's so crazy.
Oh, that is so sick.
I'm not saying that.
Okay, at least you said that.
Hey, look, kids will call you out.
Oh, we, yeah.
They know when people ain't acting right. Hey, man,
kids are honest. Kids are
That's
honest.
That's right. That is so funny.
Kids are honest, man. Kids are honest. Oh, my God.
Did y'all have a lot of kids in your congregation?
Yeah, there were several. Yeah, that were. Like I say, we moved to various congregations. Whenever my dad would, whenever the heat would get on him and they would feel like they would have to do him something, we would up change congregations. You know, so we was, the whole time I was growing up, we was in four or five congregations throughout the city.
Wow.
You
know, oh, so, my goodness. Yeah. Wow. But did he know that there was a letter of introduction that was going to be following him when he got to that next congregation?
I'm not sure how they did it, but whenever we would change congregations, it's almost like he got a clean slate. He started over again until he started messing up there. And then we would jump congregations and he got another clean slate at the next congregation.
Oh, that is so
I don't know how they were doing it, but that's what was happening.
Oh, my goodness. What about y'all never moved physically? Y'all just moved to a new congregation.
Right, right. We still stayed in the same physical house. He would just move to different congregations throughout the city. Yeah.
Wow. And when you moved out at 19, how far from home did you move?
I stayed in the same city. I literally moved about 10 minutes from where I grew up.
Okay.
Oh, okay. So you didn't have to go get used to another area then?
No, ma'am. I stayed right here. I've been right here in this city my whole life. Yeah.
You knew where the Piggly Wiggly was. You know?
I knew exactly where it was.
Oh, my goodness. How long do you think it took you to really feel comfortable being in your own place and paying bills and all that kind of stuff?
It's funny that you asked that. I was so relieved the first evening I was there. I was my mom was still working at the time. And this was back during the pager days and all that. There were no cell phones. So my mom started paging me late because when I left my parents' house that morning, I gathered up all of my belongings, loaded up into my car. I didn't tell anybody anything. I just left and I went to work. And when I got off from work, I went to my apartment that I had set up. I didn't go back to my parents' house. So I never physically told them, hey, I'm moving out, because I knew it didn't matter one way or another.
Yeah.
So I was supposed to pick my mom up from work that afternoon when I got off of work, and I forgot. So I went to my apartment, and I was chilling out at my apartment, and my mom was paging me. She kept blowing me up.
Blowing you up?
Yeah. So
paging, blowing up.
I called her back, and I was like, hey, mom, what's wrong? She's like, where are you? And I was like, I'm at home. And she was like, no, you're not. I'm at home. You're going to come pick me up. You're going to come pick me up. And I was like, no, I'm at my home.
Oh, that's funny.
Oh, my God. Wait. You didn't plan that, did you?
I planned it before. No. I didn't plan to leave her stranded, but I did plan to move out. Yeah. I truly forgot about picking my mom up from work. I really did.
Hey, look, hey, Paul. Yeah. You were so excited about getting to your own place. You forgot your mama at work.
I did.
Oh my goodness!
She's standing there waiting, looking around.
What was her response?
She see headlights on the road.
Right. What was her response when you said, "I'm at home"? I am.
Yeah.
At home.
She was like, "Where are you?" And I was like, "I'm at home." I said, "Ma, I don't live with y'all anymore. I moved out."
Wow.
And she was like, "Well, you weren't gonna tell me." I was like, "No, ma'am. Actually, I wasn't. No, you know, because
amazing.
I did not." And this may sound weird, but it's not the way I mean it. But I did not trust my mom to tell my dad.
No.
You know what I'm saying?
She would have told him.
Yeah.
She had never helped you in any other circumstance. So what basis would you have to, quote unquote, trust her that she's going to help you on something like this?
And my second brother, my brother's underneath me, he holds animosity. He hasn't talked to my mom in years and years and years because he holds her responsible for allowing my dad to throw him out at 15, you know, because he says my mom did nothing to stand up for him, you know, to say my son is a child and you're going to throw him out on the streets at 15. My mom went into self-preservation mode. You know, I'm finna do what's best for me, you know, and I understand the mindset, but it still wasn't right.
Yeah, and you're right. It is very important to understand that it was wrong. Whenever I have this conversation, I just go back to what I always say. This is why people need to understand how a cult works. Then when you see stuff like this, this is your identifying mark. This is what cults do. She's part of a cult. She's part of a high control group that has given her a value system that you need to put him out because then he'll come back. They take the prodigal son and they just twist it all up and down, man. And the Watchtower spills that stuff out. And every Jehovah's Witness parent who has a disfellowship child is sitting back waiting for the prodigal son stuff to kick in. And as you said, as you demonstrated, that stuff ain't never kicking in for some people, man.
I ain't never going back. Going what happened. I ain't going back.
I would be curious to know, you know, what religion was your mother before she became a Jehovah's Witness?
Baptist.
She was a Baptist. Yeah. What kind of family did she grow up in?
My grandmother was church going woman, went to church every Sunday, you know what I'm saying? That kind of stuff. So my grandfather wasn't real religious. He would go on occasion, but you know, my grandmother, she was went to church faithfully until she wasn't able to go no more and she passed away, you know. So my mom saw that, you know, growing up. I can't really say what the background of my dad was as far as religion. I mean, I knew my grandparents, but I never knew her to be very religious, you know. So
okay. But no, here's what I'm getting at. There's a reason why your mother did not do and help her kids as well. And I want to give it a little bit of weight on both sides. Was she raised to be docile? Or was your grandmother, did your grandfather?
Yeah, my grandmother was pretty much docile. I guess you could say laid back, but yeah. From what I saw as a kid growing up in my grandparents' house, and I spent a lot of time there. My grandfather wasn't violent or anything like that, you know, but he just wasn't very, my grandfather didn't play the leadership role, I guess you could say. My grandmother did, you know, so. And so my mom came from a position of seeing her mom have to struggle and try to make the household work and take care of the family and stuff like that. So that's, my dad came along and met her and made all these false promises and stuff. And then when the Jehovah's Witnesses stuff came into it, you know, my mom just latched onto that because she figured that was going to get her across the finish line. That was going to get her what she wanted, you know.
So she probably was looking for, she was probably looking for a man to take the lead.
Yes, yes, she was. She was just like I said, I did the opposite of the way I was raised. My mom tried to have the opposite of the way that she was raised. You know, she wanted to have that man just do everything and just be the housewife and just, you know, but she gave up a lot in order to live that life. She gave up control of her own life. Yeah.
Okay. See, that makes a lot of sense now. Yeah. She didn't want to be that woman that was carrying all the baggage and taking the family and having to be the lead and everything. Because there's always a reason why people do things.
Right. Right.
You know.
That's the reason. She and I have talked about it over the years. And you know, my grandmother used to have to catch the bus and all kind of bad weather and stuff like that to go to work. Well, my grandfather would half work when he did. You know, so my mom didn't want to have to live that life, so she met my dad. My dad promised her that she wasn't have to live this life. And for all intents and purposes, for the longest time, my mom never really had to work. But she gave up the ability to take care of herself, and she became under his thumb, basically. You know, she had to do what he said, when he said, how he said it, for as long as he said it. Just like another child in the house, you know?
Yeah. Right.
Yeah. It's a very powerful thing when people are told that this is what God wants you to do.
Yes. Yes.
And they believe it. Once you convince a person, whatever it is, man, this is something that God wants you to do, people will do. We saw it on 9/11. Yes. Individuals have been convinced that God want me to take this Boeing forth. You know,
He wants
me to fly this thing, this Boeing, right into this building. And you just go on down the line of all this stuff when you think about it, as Jehovah's Witnesses and just religious belief systems in general, that's told people things to do, and God gonna be happy if you do it. You know,
I subscribe more to the belief system now. I guess you could say I describe myself as being agnostic. I'm not saying that it doesn't exist, but I'm not saying it does. And from my personal experience and the things that I've learned, I haven't met anybody in my personal life that profess to be religious that actually walk the walk that they talk. I've never met it. It's all you have to do is sit back and watch them.
Yeah.
And I've come to the conclusion that religion was created to control people.
Oh yeah.
Religion was created by men.
It's a wonderful tool, man.
Yes.
I tell people all the time, you know, I spent 30 years of my life arguing over, you know, Jesus on a light pole or him dying on a telephone pole. I can't do that no more, man.
Right.
Well, you know, I feel like when it comes to religion, it's really hard to live up to all those demands anyway.
Yes, yes.
Because
yes,
you're yes. only human, and as a human, you are going to make mistakes.
Yes.
But it just depends, like different religions will determine how bad your sin is.
Yes.
Or
yes.
how bad somebody's going to treat you, or, you know, like just looking at the way we were raised as Jehovah's Witnesses, if someone gets in trouble, you know, sex before marriage, you know, they may not be cast out from their family in these other churches. But when you go to the high control religions like Jehovah's Witnesses, oh, you're going to be shunned
right.
just for doing something that is so natural to being a human, you know?
Right.
So it just depends on that.
This is something, and I got this from my life of growing up too, but I've told this to my kids. I was like, people use the expression, nobody's perfect. We all make mistakes. And that's 100% true. But as human beings, there are some things that we know is wrong before we do it. And we do it anyway.
Yeah, it's true.
And then we turn around and use the excuse, well, I'm not perfect. Yeah. No, you knew what you was doing was wrong. You did it anyway. And I saw that a lot in the Jehovah's Witnesses. You know?
Oh, yeah.
But when you saw that in the Jehovah's Witnesses, did you see people getting turned in and getting disfellowshipped? Or did you see people doing it and walking away and not even getting in trouble?
Both. I saw the ones that weren't connected, the ones that weren't in the cliques. Those are the ones that got disfellowshipped. But the ones that were connected, or they were somebody's son or somebody's brother or whatever, they may have gotten a reproof, private reproof or something like that, but they didn't get kicked out, you know?
Yeah.
Exactly. What about those brothers at the store? You saw those, you want to relate that story about what you saw?
Yeah. It's two different occasions. The first time, this was just a normal brother. He wasn't a ministerial servant or anything like that. And I try to avoid using names because I don't know where these people are now. I don't know if they even still alive.
There's no need. So, yeah, the story stands for itself.
But I was working at this convenience store. It was a typical neighborhood store in all the cities across America. Family in the neighborhood owned it or whatever. I'd been knowing them since I was a kid. So they offered me a job there. Everybody in the community would come in and out of that store. You know, people trusted you because they saw your face in there all the time. So this one particular brother walks in the store. He walks in. I'm at the first register when you walk in the door. He speaks, comes in. I don't pay him any attention. But I'm looking over, and he's over toward the back corner of the store where the meat is. So I saw him, but I still didn't think he was up to no good. So I walked out to go do something. I forget something in the store. And when I walked around that aisle, he was bent over. He was stuffing a pack of meat in his socks, trying to get his pants leg down over the socks. And I saw him. And he looked up at me like a deer in headlights. And I just looked at him like, yeah, I see you. I see what you're doing.
I got your number. I got your number. Yeah.
So he hurried up, pulled his pants leg down, and he hurried up, went out of the store. And to this day, I never told anybody who he was. I've told this story a lot of times, but I never told anybody who he was. And for a long time, he was panicked every time he saw me. He thought I was going to tell on him.
Tell on him.
And the second one was, this brother here was actually an elder. He walked in the same store. And this guy, he walked in and spoke to me. He walked directly to the back cooler, gets a 12-pack of Milwaukee's Best out of there. Cheapest beer you can get on earth, damn near. He walks in, gets a 12-pack of Milwaukee's Best. Looks like he's looking for some other stuff on the back end caps of the aisle.
Then
he walks all the way to the far corner of the store, up the last aisle, and out the door.
Wow.
Yes.
Gone.
Yes.
That's a shame.
And it's, you know, I think it's really sad because when you think about the two brothers, they knew a Jehovah's Witness worked in that store.
Yes. Yeah.
Now, who was the owner? Was the owner a witness?
No, the owner was just a regular family in the neighborhood.
You know? Oh, okay.
And so
they put you in that bad situation.
The first brother, he knows for sure that I saw him. Now, the second brother that was the elder, I don't know if he realized that I saw him walk out of the door without paying, you know, because he didn't hesitate. When he made it to that back aisle, he was up the aisle and out the door, you know.
Were these brothers struggling financially?
Oh, I don't know. I mean, I was a teenager, so I don't know what their financial situation was at that time. This, like, I was 16, 17 years old, you know, working in this corner store. So, but I do know that neither one of them had high-paying jobs, you know. Yeah. So nobody in the congregation had high-paying. Well, there was one brother, he worked at a chemical plant, but the rest of them, no, they had menial jobs, you know.
That's pretty bad. And that's, I guess, that's the point. That's where I'm going with this. You knew that the kind of work that they did, you know, so, yes, and then they're trying to be Jehovah's Witnesses and, you know, they probably trying to have stay-at-home wives and with kids. And so now they're trying to come down to the store.
And they didn't, of course, they didn't know this about me, but I was the last one that's going to snitch on them with all the stuff that I was into. I was the last one that's going to tell.
Oh, my God. So the Jehovah's Witnesses, like we say, I'll say this. There was an individual that found out that I was an ex-Jehovah's Witness, and they proceeded to tell me that there's nothing wrong with Jehovah's Witnesses, this and that, blah, blah, blah. And of course, you know, they didn't understand the whole situation behind, you know, why I'm an ex-witness, because they never really even asked me why I left. They just came at me that they got some friends that are Jehovah's Witnesses and they're good people and blah, blah, blah. But like Paul's saying, you got to dig a little bit deeper, because just because you see people on the surface, that's what you're looking at. You're looking at surface stuff, because Jehovah's Witnesses, they really have this thing about perception, about how people look at them.
So
you think of these people as all this and all that, and all to find out, if you dig a little deeper into the situation, they may not be the people that you think they are.
Exactly. Exactly.
You know?
Yeah.
And I know that these people, it's not the people, it's the organization and the cult that they choose to follow. And they do bad things without realizing that they're doing bad things in the name of this religion. You know, they affect and destroy lives without even realizing it, you know, because they think that what they're doing is commanded by God.
True. Very, very powerful belief. Very powerful belief.
I think the other thing that really hits the Jehovah's Witnesses in a bad way is, you know, every time you turn around, they're being told to live a simple life.
Yes.
Don't be normal. Don't be like the world. Don't go to college.
Yes, yes.
And so you could have people that are working full-time jobs and they're still barely making, paying their bills. And we were like that. Before we left this religion, I was working full time. JT was working full time, but we were living in Alexandria, Virginia, which is a very expensive place to live.
Right.
And so
it
was like, wow, we were working full time and we were just barely making it.
Right.
You know?
Right.
So when you
saw that
up
a lot.
In that,
that's a
bad place to be.
Yeah, we saw a lot of witnesses. One of the problems in the Washington, D.C. area, because the cost of living is somewhat high, in our congregation and the other congregations, a lot of witnesses, they had to move every year because the apartments here in the D.C. area, they're very high. So when your lease is up, it bounces up. And now we were just talking just the other evening about what's happening now. You know, Amazon is moving its headquarters here in the Washington D.C. man, and the apartments, they're just moving into the $2,000, $3,000, and $4,000 a month because they can afford it.
Wow.
And
we
were just talking about, for a lot of the witness friends, man, they're gonna be in trouble. They're gonna be in trouble, man.
Yes. They're not gonna be able to afford it. Yeah.
They're not. And I was looking on the internet the other day and I just said, well, let's just find out what our old apartment is renting for. A studio is going for $1,500, and the apartment that we were in is ranging from $2,000 to $4,000 a month.
That's exactly right.
Wow.
And I'm like, you
that's unbelievable.
But see, you're only 15 minutes from downtown DC. You hit 395 and you cross the 14th Street Bridge in 15 minutes. To live close to downtown Washington in the year 2021, you're going to pay for that. You're going to pay for that.
Yeah. Right. So it's going to be interesting to see what happens with Jehovah's Witnesses when it comes time to pay bills and the Armageddon hasn't come to save them. What kind of final thoughts do you have to tell our audience about your personal experience and things that you want people to know about?
Basically, I can sum it up by saying that it is a cult. I realize that word is triggering to a lot of people that's in it, but I'm sorry, that's what it is. And if you are one of the ones that truly want to get out, it can be done. I'm not going to tell you to just pack up your stuff and move. You have to analyze your situation, your circumstances, see how it's going to affect your life.
Yeah.
You know, but you can do it. You just have to put the pieces in place. You know, take your time. Don't rush and do things. You've endured it all this time. You can do it for a few more months. You know, and get your stuff together, and leave. You know, yeah. you can if you want to, but it has to be that you truly want to leave. The individual wants to leave, because if you haven't made up your mind and you're doing it for other reasons or whatever, then you can be persuaded to come back. But if you know that it's not true and it's not what you want, once you make up that resolve to leave, put the necessary pieces in place that's necessary in your life to walk away from it.
Yeah.
Right. Excellent advice, man. Excellent advice.
And Paul, you want to tell our listening audience how they can watch your other videos?
Oh, yeah.
Sure. I'm on YouTube at Exjw in Louisiana. Paul, I'm in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. It's a pretty big city, but it's not a big city. So, I got I forget how many I got uploaded, but I got a few videos uploaded on there. I'm going to do more, but I got to put this disclaimer out there. Mine is not going to be like Lady C and JT's.
It's not supposed to be like ours. It's supposed to be yours. It's supposed to be yours.
Right.
Yeah, he did an excellent job. He held our attention and everything. So y'all go out and check him out XJW in Louisiana.
Yeah.
Because there's so many people that's putting videos out.
Yeah.
Oh, let me put it.
Telling their story, man. People are telling their story. I mean, people are telling their stories, man.
They are. Go ahead.
I just wanted to try to help someone that, you know, my story can possibly help. You know, I realize everyone didn't go through the same scenarios and same situations that I did. You know, from what I understand, some of the things have changed in the organization over the years or whatever, you know, but the core beliefs is still the same. You know, the way that they instruct people to believe in certain things hasn't changed, you know, so.
Yeah. Only the window dressings has changed, man.
Yes.
That's all. Just the window dressing. We look back all the way back to Charles Taz Russell, and we see exactly the same thing. I'm going to promise you something's going to happen real soon. All you got to do is just hang in there and keep hawking the books. And that's been the basic story for 150 years. Just hawk the books. It's coming soon. You know,
I've been, I saw a video I watched the other day, and I can't remember what was the creator's, but they were saying that the pyramid at Russell's grave has been removed.
Yeah.
Like, a lot of people didn't even know it existed. And I was like, I found out that existed back in the 90s. And it's like, that's how I found out that it was based off pyramidology and all of that stuff.
I know, right?
Yeah, and I'm like, but they far removed themselves from that now, but this is their origins.
This is their history, man.
Yeah.
They wrote it, they own it.
Yes.
I'm not giving them no slack. They don't the organization don't give friends no slack. So we're gonna hold their feet to the fire the same way they hold the friends' feet to the fire.
Yeah.
Exactly.
But I know one thing, I am not complaining about my childhood anymore. Let me put a bow on this then. All right, Paul, we want to thank you so much for being on The Critical Thought. This has been Lady C.
And this has been JT.
Thank you guys for having me.
You are so welcome.
Absolutely.
And we'll see you all on the next episode.
This program was sponsored by Critical Thinkers.